So, Celso, hello. We are here in the middle of the Romanian Championship, eDoc Championship. We have IGP, we have Mondio, we have BH. And first of all, in order to present you, we are friends. Then you trained me a couple of times. And yesterday you also judged me. So we have the whole package now. So we're really on the field of Mondio Ring, where Mondio Ring 1, 2 happened. And now we're in the during a break of Mondio Ring 3. First of all, I want to ask you, with your experience, because you have lots of experience in Portugal, but also internationally, what is Mondio Ring for you, as for a normal person that maybe sees something, but how would you define Mondio Ring?
Well, I define Mondio Ring not like a sport that is better than the others, but a sport that is different from the others. It's for me, I judge also IGP, and I help others in IGP also. In other disciplines also, I help them. And I consider all the disciplines very, very much important. But Mondio Ring inspires me, because Mondio Ring has something that after the dog is made on level 3, it's much more fun to train constantly, because it's always challenging. It comes a judge like me, I'm an inventive guy.
Yes, you are. And I can testify to that.
And I always invent some stuff. Even for training, I invent stuff all the time. And this is much more fun, because sometimes you have a dog that is full program, and one day you win the best world championship in an object car, like I've won it in 2015, and next year I try to improve other exercises, and here comes a guy that was studying my object guard. He could steal it on the last passage by one single second. He could take it.
Wow.
Because there was one moment that the dog was distracted, because we don't do this that thing for a while. So it's very, very good sport for us, for the dogs, that he stimulates a lot. And it's a very technical sport, because each exercise needs a different kind of technique. It's not something that we do like a routine, it's not boring. We need to be all the time thinking and looking what we are doing, what we are performing, and then we go to the trial and we test it to see how it goes.
The fun part is it's always changing, because for example this year we have construction as a thematic here.
Yes, yes.
But another year we had fishing, another year. So if I prepare for 1 year for an exercise like this, I will never have the same, even if I have
exactly.
you as a judge, because you're
exactly.
very inventive.
Exactly.
So we'll that's always
and,
fun.
And it's beautiful, because you
and
can
challenging.
And challenging, because then you can unite the whole world.
Yeah.
I'm in the sport. The first time I started to wear the suit, it was in 1998, and Palomo was there, and so after all of these years, we are still training and doing things together, so the friendship is also very good, and it's something that can maintain friendships for a long period of time.
Of course.
He doesn't live near me, he lives in Madrid, and I live in Portugal.
I live in Bucharest, so
yes,
we have we wouldn't have met without Mondio Ring. So
exactly, I travel all over the world. I've been in almost seven parts of because since USA, Russia, Israel, all Europe. I have even been invited to Philippines, but I could not, because it was too far trip,
yeah.
And I was working in the police, so I could not have vacations to go. I would love to help him also, but I couldn't at the time. And it's beautiful, because you can unite all people, and everybody can share, can bring some ideas in.
Mm-hmm.
We have rules, but then the rules, they accept teams, and they accept different kinds of behavior. So, and the defenses of the handler are always different. This one, we invented four people on the defense.
Yes.
It was the decoys with me, and we're talking about it, and we create a magnificent defense.
Yes.
And it's something that when it's done with a good spirit, is really fun and challenging for us. And I think, like People sometimes on this sport, what I don't like it, people think on points.
Of course.
And this is not a sport of points. Because the things are always different, we cannot compare them. You in a trial you can make 300 points in 300, but then in the other trial you can make 150. Because the dog has to be really good to maintain a score. Yes, when they are ready and when they are really good, we saw one of the dogs already that passed today, and he maintains a good score. Mm-hmm. There is always variations because of the decoys, because of the environment, because of the field. And that's what is really beautiful. And I do it for so many years.
Yeah.
And I still
How many years?
This. Oh, I started in 1998 to do the Mondial. Until now, and I persist for doing my whole career. I have several dogs in level 3. I made 18 world championships with 18. Sometimes with two dogs, one in two, one in three, one in one, and one in three. Because I love this. I have three dogs, one in three, one in two, one in one, and I have fun all the time competing with them. And they are completely different.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to.
Is the same breed or is different?
It's a Dutch Harder.
Okay.
A female, a male on two, a Malinois, and another Malinois female on one.
But so, even the Malinois, they're very different.
Yes, even the Malinois, they are completely different because there is a female and a male. The male is more Belgian line, so he's more crazy or more obsessed.
Mm-hmm.
And the female is a mix between the French and the Belgian, so she's more sensitive and she's more young, so she needs more support. And one I need to control, the other I need to say go, go, go. So it's very, very challenging.
So you cannot apply the same?
No,
it's not very strict, you know, like
this is
one, two, three movement.
That's the beauty of all this.
Yes, this is why I want to.
You can buy a dog that is world champion, but if you don't know how to make a team with him, you cannot. Yesterday, one guy that was competing, it was a really good dog, but in obedience, he was having an attitude that it was a female, and the female was fighting against him in the obedience.
With the handler?
With the handler,
yes.
Because the handler was screaming at her.
Okay.
And the females, they are special on this.
Mm-hmm.
They don't like, they shouted at.
Yeah.
So during the obedience, he was shouting. So she says, "No, apport, no, send away, no, nothing." He's shouting at me, so I don't do nothing. And in the bites, she was really good.
Okay.
But he could not make a perfect team. And I give him an example. A few years back, I go in a Cup of Portugal and I lose the first two exercises, and everybody was happy. Oh, now is our days. He lost, send
our,
away and apport.
It's
our chance. And I look on my dog, Furia, and I say, shit, we are going to lose. Okay, let's have fun losing. So I start playing with her. I changed the mood of the dog because she was going down because she feels.
Of course. Your frustration.
So I changed my energy and I really play with her. And then until the last, she don't lose no more points. And then she win.
Huh.
And when I come out of the field, some people come to me and say, how could you change? You were losing like hell, and then suddenly start to smile and play. Emotions. This is a sport that you have to make a team. Sometimes you have to say, no, 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 don't do that. But other times you say, go, 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 take your chance. And one of the things more important on this, our dogs, a monitoring dog, needs to be clever and he needs to take decisions.
So he's not like a robot.
No, he cannot be
because
like a robot.
Because lots of people think of Malinois, and I see this, we see this all the time, you more than me. Everybody wants a Malinois because they're like a robot and they do everything. And it's not this. And I tell us more why it's so important, because this is very important what
because
you said.
Because like things are always different, you cannot format the head of the dog. You have to let the dog think what he's doing. You have to give the chance to sometimes make mistakes when we are training, and but also let him take good decisions. And that's my key success. People think, but how you have so much success? I let my dogs think. And I want him, when they take good decisions, to say, very good, I'm very happy. And when they take bad decisions, no, 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 I don't want that. Please, do another thing. So after a while, the dog wants to please me. Because in this sport, they can change everything. So you cannot mechanize nothing. The dog has to understand really well what he can or what he can't and do it by himself, because he has to adapt himself. You see, for the bites, sometimes he has to go low, sometimes he has to go up, sometimes he cannot go up or low, he has to go in the middle. The obstacles are always different, so they never know. The behavior of the decoy, yeah, always changing, and they need a constant adaptation. So it's a huge amount of exercises, so you cannot mechanize all. It's impossible to mechanize. If you mechanize, the dog will lose, because then it suddenly says, okay, I don't never seen this, so what I do, Papa? I'm waiting for your hours. I'm waiting for your command. But he cannot say nothing. He gives one command.
One command, and that's all.
And that's all. Otherwise, it's zero.
Analyze the situation and take his decision.
Exactly.
So what do you think is the most challenging thing for in Mondioring? For somebody who's looking at us and maybe thinking about starting, what's the most challenging thing that that you find after all your years of experience?
I think Mondioring evolved a lot, and she's still evolving, because it's
yet it's still
worldwide.
It's a young sport compared to others.
Yes, compared to like IGP French rings or Belgian ring or even KNPV, it's much younger. But also it's constantly evolving, because like I say, everybody can contribute to make the spirit, and the spirit of the sport is like during the obedience should be like natural things, mm-hmm, and during the bites the decoy should behave like if you don't have the suit, so it has to be like a natural thing, mm-hmm, so but with control and with a lot of discipline. But this has to be balanced, because if the dog cannot take decisions, how can the dog then change when he has only an opportunity and he don't take it? Because no, my papa says I have to take my leg or I have to take my arm. No, yeah, no, he has to change. He has to adapt himself. And that's why the first thing I recommend to anybody that wants to start in obedience or on the bite, they need a lot of technical things, and they need that the dog can think and see a lot of it. Don't just show him one thing. Show him a lot. Show him in obedience a lot. You see dogs in on three today, and during the healing, there are dogs that lose more than half of the points during the healing. Okay. Because I invented it today.
Yes.
It was today, I was thinking, okay, so what we do? So I invent a movement on the start, and almost all the dogs in three, they was confused. What the hell is doing?
Yeah, even in one you put the movement, yes, which is strange. You never start like this. And
But it was here that I remember to do it.
And there's food on the field also, yes, which is a challenge for some dogs.
Also movements, different movements of the handler when he's walking. Yes. And the dog has to adapt himself to the thing. And that's why it's so challenging, because normally a dog that is 4 years old,
he
takes all points on the healing. But then the problem is so huge, so large, that even when it's on three, a dog with 4 or 5 years of training can lose the points on the healing, because the healing is always challenging. And so when you go train, you have to challenge yourself. You have to think, whoa, what the hell can I show to my dog that I didn't show before? And that's why it's so beautiful, because in you don't go on a routine. Okay, I have to walk a step, I have to be... No, I have to show him different things. So that in the end, when I go to the competition and the judge invents the stuff, mm-hmm, the dog is ready.
This is exactly what I wanted to ask you. How do you prepare for... What's some tips and tricks? Maybe not your secret, but how do you prepare mentally and also with your dog for this? Because also it's very important for the handler. You said about emotions, about the team, and I know it even on myself, and I think you can confirm this. If you're in a bad state of mind, you as a handler, you transmit this to the dog, and then it goes like a vicious circle, you know?
Especially females.
Especially females.
Especially females.
So how do you prepare?
Because they are very sensible with the handlers.
Yes.
And the base of the preparation is to leave good bases. Mm-hmm. And bases, I prepare my dogs with base that they can understand variations of each exercise. Mm-hmm. I don't prepare my dogs like a robo. I prepare them, okay, this is the healing. The healing can have this variation, that variation, that variation, that variation, that variation. And then I have an amount of variations that I show to a young dog. And sometime I show them.
Okay.
Once in a while I show them. And after a while I test to see, okay, in training I test.
Yeah.
Do you still remember this? Okay, he still remembers. So this meant that he was really organized on his head. So I do it for the healing, I do it for rapport, I do it for the jumps, I do for all obedience and bite, these kind of things.
Okay.
It's like laws that he has to interpret it and has to understand what they are the principles, and then he can change, he can adapt himself. And I accept, and when he do something that a very important tip, I don't correct mistakes.
But what do you do with mistakes? Because we have mistakes.
I don't pay.
So not giving the reward is actually, well, it's a kind
punishment,
of kind
but
of punishment,
not a direct punishment,
it's not a direct,
you see?
Yes, yes.
So, and especially I jackpot every good behavior.
So you reward, but when you have a very good, then it's a jackpot, it's a huge
exactly.
reward.
So, after a while, the dog tries to make good behaviors, tries to please me.
Because he wants the jackpot.
My dogs, sometimes I train, I make 50 attacks, I recall, and I don't give nothing. Mm-hmm. Because they want to please me. I say, good girl, or good boy, and they are, oh, good. He's happy with me, because with time, I induce this on the like a team, a partnership. A team don't need to be paid all the time.
Yeah.
But also, if that partnership is made on power, and one is the boss and the other is a slave, this will not work. Mm-hmm. So what we do, we teach, and the idea of teaching is to make a partnership between you and the dog, and you are like a team, like pals, you know, like friends. Okay, I help my friend, not because he's going to pay me,
yeah.
but I help him because I want to see him happy. So this is the main issue, this is the main concept. We want the dog be play with us so that we are happy, so that we make him also happy. So it's like one helping the other to go in.
I think this is a very good advice for someone who wants to start or who already is doing mondioring. And this leads me to another question. What would be something that you would not recommend, something, so the opposite. What is something never to do? Of course, I don't think about beating your dog or something illegal or something, but as a trainer or a handler that you want to progress, what is something you wouldn't recommend someone to do?
I don't recommend nobody to try to do it by herself without really understanding good the sport.
Okay.
Because it's very huge sport. Nowadays there are a lot of people that are on sport
yes.
already. It's very easy to acquire a mentorship or a formation by internet nowadays. So people don't need to try to make mistakes. And because mistakes that are put in a young dog, they will stay for a long period of time. It's not easy to take mistakes.
Yeah.
It's better to start from the beginning really proper with a good concepts and do it step by step, increasing more information, but with people that already know. It's like when I learn the truth, I learn with old guys. I learn with the people that have more experience than me. My masters teach me, and for a long time I was with them, and I when I had a problem, I contact and say, hey, I have a problem here. And the guy say, okay, because they know my dogs, they know my job. I say,
yeah.
okay, do this, do that, until I could have the baggage enough to do it by myself.
Yeah.
Because I come from IGP, and I do agility, and I do obedience before. So all the concepts of those sports, they can, some pieces they can be adapted.
Of
but
course.
You need very well to understand the sport, to adapt them on this sport, because they are different. And so we need to really understand what to do. So if we follow somebody that already built 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 level 3 dogs, for sure that person knows the solution. And also the person should choose somebody that is on the same concept. Why? Because I tell you why. There was people that they teach me a lot. What they teach me more, it was what not to do.
Yeah, that's why I asked you.
They was, for instance, their mentality was, you are my slave, you are my dog, you are my slave.
Yeah.
You have to obey because I say so, and I don't care about what you feel. And I see that, for me, it makes no sense.
Of course.
My first animal I trained, it was a rabbit. So a rabbit you cannot hit, you cannot push, you cannot punish. So the second animal I trained, it was a bird. You cannot also punish.
Of course.
So what I take from this spirit, I prefer somebody that is training on the same sequence of training, mm-hmm. you see? And don't go after somebody that wants to mechanize you. And yeah. mechanize your dog.
Like a robot, yes.
When a dog has a lot of mechanization in the mind, then it's very hard to make him take decisions. Because you can imagine, you are now you have 30. Since you are a boy, they never let you choose the food, never let you choose the shoes, never let you choose nothing. And then suddenly you have 30, and they say, now you choose your shoes and yours.
You're blocked. You don't know what to do.
What are I choose?
Yes.
I never chosen in my life nothing.
It's like someone who's in a prison on his life,
exactly.
and then you give him freedom, he doesn't know what to
exactly.
do with it.
Exactly. So that's why it's so important that this is not mechanized. There are sports for these kind of things, and if people really love these sports, or they like that kind of work, maybe it's easy for them to go in that sport because that fits good. In our sport doesn't fit good, mechanization. And I see often in the world when I'm traveling, people that do mountaineering, but they train like if it was in another sport.
Yeah.
They was preparing. But
because lots of them have baggages,
no
like
sense.
You said, and they have the baggage and they think it's the same thing.
Yeah, but it's not.
It's not,
and
yes.
It makes no sense.
Right.
One of the countries that more evolved, it was Israel in the last years.
Yes.
And I was lucky enough to be there in the starting when they start the first trials. And one of the persons responsible for the sport there, it was a guy, very good decoy in French ring.
Mm-hmm.
And when he called me there, he says, okay, about French ring, I understand, but I need to understand what is the money ring. So this is how important is the attitude of a person. He is a great guy in French ring, but he comes to Mondering and says, okay, I know this sport is really good, and I'm good on that one, but I need to understand the other thing, because it's similar, but it's not equal.
Of course.
And that's why he was there and he tried to absorb the most advices I give him, and he absorbed it so well that they are growing.
Yes, I can certify to that.
That's why I think the good mentality is not being stubborn,
yeah.
it's being clever and
open-minded.
Yeah. And even me, I don't know everything. And sometimes I've seen so many dogs for so many years. I had a club with 25 dogs doing mountaineering, and there was 9 level 3 dogs at the time. And with this team, I go to World Championship, and with 4 brothers, we take the 3rd place.
Wow.
As a team. And they don't even give us the prize. They give the prize to the Belgians because they thought, because Belgium was a bigger team,
yeah.
and they are there for more years, they call them on podium and they give you the prize. He goes, no, it was us. So they have to take the prize of them, make a new podium to give us, because we have the 3rd and 4th place individual.
That's funny story.
And they have to take the prize and give it to us as a team,
yeah.
third place. So even like this, I don't know at all. Sometimes I'm challenged by this.
Yeah.
And I'm always constantly learning. And sometimes a question from even from a guy that never made a sport can make me think, if
right.
I ever saw this, does my dog knows this? So we have to be maintain humble.
Yes.
We have to maintain open mind, listen to people. And sometimes you say, okay, this I understand. Okay, but this, for what I know, it's okay. This, okay, this is valid. Let's see it. And this is very good because it maintains us always sharp. You see, you cannot sleep on the job. You have to maintain your mind always working, and this is very much stimulation.
When people see, this is more of a question for a general audience, because people who are watching us maybe have a dog, want to have a dog, and they see the, especially the Malinois, not only, but especially Malinois doing all these great things, even on this competition and in general. And I want to ask you, why would you not buy a Malinois? What's the, why? Because I think people are getting Malinois without knowing what a Malinois represents. Especially if they're not taking him for a dog sport, and then they find themselves with a dog that is impossible or bad. They say it's bad, you know, it's not the dog's fault, it's never the dog's fault. So I want to have your advice on this.
I'm a breeder of Malinois
especially
since more than 20 years. My first litter was a long time ago, and I have a lot of dogs that I title on three, but I don't make so many litters. Sometimes 2-3 years I make one litter, because I make litters for me and for my friends, because for people that I see that they have more or less the same idea.
No, it's not for the money.
No.
Okay, it's the not money, for the fame.
No.
Okay,
just
to be clear.
it's not important for me.
People
situation.
Say that you make money with this, and there are people who want to make money.
There are
with
people
this.
That yes. make too much money
yes.
on this, and I don't blame them. But I also think that more than breeding a dog is providing that, or maybe let them have a person that can provide him a wealthy life. For, and there are very, very few people I know that have a Malinois outside the sport. That Malinois is happy.
Okay.
Because it's not only a Malinois. I train all the races. And,
yes, I know.
In
that.
Lithuania, I was training a Border Collie.
You train boxers also.
Boxers.
That's why we're friends.
So all the races can go in. The easiest race for this is Malinois or Dutch Shepherd, because they have more time of selecting. But in reality, sometimes people ask me, oh, do you have a puppy, the Malinois, for what you want it? What time you have for it? How many time you can expend to do something with the dog? Because there is, like, if you have the body of Ben Johnson with the mind of Einstein in one dog, and then you put him in a place where he has nothing to do, he has nothing to expend energy, so it's like an atomic bomb that is ready to explode.
So,
and that's not
so good. Really, your advice would be, don't get a Malinois if you don't want to do some sport or some work with him.
Exactly, because...
So there's no such thing, and I can confirm, as a couch Malinois.
No. No dog, people have to think this. No dog is happy on the couch. When they are good in the couch, they are depressive.
Right.
Because it's not
just
natural.
Like humans.
Like humans.
Exactly.
When people stay too much on the couch, they'll be on depression for a while.
Right.
One thing is you go there in the middle of the day or in the end of the day and you stay 1 hour on the sofa to rest. That is okay. But if you are more than 1 hour on a sofa every single day, this will be a problem in your mind also. So in the mind of a dog that is active, very active, it will be much more. So. I train also pets in my school, and I see that they are happy when they are playing. They are happy when they are interacting. They are not happy to lie down on the sofa and
having
sleep.
A job.
You need to have a job,
of course.
The best example is COVID.
Yeah.
When COVID come and people was closed inside the house, they get crazy. And they have TV, they have internet, they can communicate by internet, they can communicate. Now imagine a dog in a house, in a sofa, but he cannot communicate, he cannot do nothing. So what he does?
But remember during COVID, who were the ones that saved us? The dogs.
Yeah.
The only people who were left to, let alone to take go outside, yes, were the people with the pets.
Yes.
So now we have to think about this.
So I think people have to do this. And most of all, people have to think that is taking a dog is a project for at least 10, 11 years.
Right.
A Malinois is a very healthy dog, and he needs now Furia has 13. The last one I had, it was Gara. Gara died with 15, and she competed until 9 years and a half. Furia competed until 10 years, and she's still okay. The dog before, Cobra, the father of Furia, he died with 14 years and a half. He competed until the 9. Before, another dog that I have, it was Hari. She lived until 15 years and a half, almost 16 years.
It's a long time, long time project.
The career of her, it was 9, 10 years, and then they have a 5 years pension. Right. So during these 5 years, it's very important that they have a good life, and that before we prepare it. And normally my retired dogs, they live in my house with me. They live among us. So that they have more contact, but also more freedom, because when we go walking, they go with us. When we go biking, they go with us, so that they can have more time to rest, more time to open it. And once in a while, when they are really old, I let them do bites, because they need it.
Yeah.
Furia, now she's 13, and when she doesn't bite for a few days, she wants to bite, so she starts. Sometimes she comes to me and do it like this. Hey, come on, please. So we have to give them what they need.
Satisfaction.
The satisfaction, so that, because we want them to be happy.
Of course.
And for this period, people have to think, I'm going to buy a dog. Are you single? Are you going to be married? Are you going to have kids? If you have to have kids, your dog has to be really sociable. If you already have kids, the dog has to be really sociable. So people need to understand this, because otherwise the dog is like the dog is not like a car.
Yes.
A car, you have a sport car, but then you married, you have a kid, and you say, okay, I will sell the car and will buy a van for the kids. And it's because the car has no emotions, but the dog has emotions.
Right.
And so it's more difficult for him. I believe they can adapt himself, because if you take a dog that is restrained because he has kids at home and people don't trust him, or because he was not well socialized or trained, and then you give him to another person that has more space and time, the dog will be more happy, for sure.
Yeah, he can adapt.
Sure. But that transition, it's also an emotional shock.
Of course.
Because imagine that you live, because they see us like our kids.
Of course.
And we are like the fathers. When suddenly they lose the father, oh shit. So it's very difficult in the beginning. And that's why I think people, when they have a dog, they have to think long. For instance, sometimes I say to women, they have a dog and they sleep with the dog in the bed. Say, okay. But then when you have a kid, for the dog sleep in the bed, it's not the same, because when the kid is really small, you have to protect him. And the dog, without being intentional, he could fall on the baby, and
my boxer would kick me out of the bed.
Oh, also, most of the time they go and they start to push.
Of course, they want the whole bed.
Yeah, so it's also not good. Yeah. So we have to think this. My first dog jumped on sofa. My second dog don't. Why? Because I see my first dog, when he died, 16 years and a half, I had to put him sleep, because he fall on the sofa descending.
Yeah.
And he get hurt, and he could not walk anymore.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, shit,
not
why
good.
I let him go on the sofa in the first place? Because after you let him go, it's very hard to say, no, go anymore.
Yes.
So My next dog, the bed is like this height, so they can, they are old, they can go in and they can go out. But sofa or bed, no, okay. Please, no. Gaga, when she took fourth place in the World Championship, she slept with me for a few days, but I was sleeping on the ground.
Okay.
So I was sleeping on the ground, there was full of room of people, so each one has his own dog sleeping with him. So instead of living in a crate, I opened and I let her sleep with me, but I was on the ground.
On the
when
ground.
I return home and I sleep on my bed, she didn't come up. She see me up, no, the bed, no. If you are on the ground, good.
Okay.
And that's an advice. If you want to have a moment of more emotional with your dog, it's better that you go to his bed or to, or you go on the ground and where you have it. And then this doesn't change nothing, because when
right.
you stand or when you are on your bed or on sofa, this is a completely image for the dog, because dog sees images and he guard it. So we have to really be clear on this.
So thank you very much for this discussion about Mondioring, about dogs, about emotion and your passion for this. And I could feel it here, and I'm sure the people watching could feel it also. So it was really a
training
pleasure.
Training dogs is emotions. People think is giving food or clicking or putting equal or correcting or giving toys. No. It's emotions. Training dogs establishing a relationship between another human, another animal, one animal, and a human. That's why it's so beautiful. You need to communicate different languages, and you need to make both on the same emotion and both connected. You know, the other day I was competing, and when I was returning to my young dog on lie down distractions, I don't look on the dog. And when I come out, people say, why you don't look on your dog? Because when I look on her, we are communicating.
Of course.
And I want her to understand she's okay. So I don't need to look on her, say, what are you doing? What are you? No, no. I trust you. So I don't need to look on you, because I trust that you will be okay. And that's the communication. You know, people sometimes don't understand. They see, why is doing this? But it's because of this. And that's why it's so beautiful and it's so good to train the dog. Sometimes I see people that have dogs and they don't communicate well with other humans. But I'm a little bit like that.
Yeah, me too.
I communicate better with animals than with the humans.
I'm like that also.
Why? Because I'm too frontal.
Yeah.
I'm the kind of person that says, I love you, I don't love you.
Yeah.
You did it good, I didn't was pleased with this. And all my friends for a long time, they are like this. And we don't get regrets,
yeah.
You see, like the dogs. And that's why, and some people I put away from myself because of this, because I see they don't understand this kind of behavior. So I prefer to be a little bit far away. And my main issue is that when you go on dog world training, you think you are training emotions, you are communicating with another being, because it's a different being and there is a completely different communication.
Yeah.
So has to create a bond. This is the beautiful of this, is the bond. Okay, so I hope help people to understand.
For
and
sure.
In the future they can go better and better, because we are always improving. If we have an open mind, if you have a good spirit, we are always improving ourselves. And I made mistakes. I'm human. Also my dogs can make mistakes, because it's also human. It's not a human, but it's an animal, but it also can make mistakes.
Of course.
And we have to understand this tolerance.
Thank you very much, Celso, for all this, sharing this wisdom. It really helped everybody and myself. Thank you again for everything that you did for and are doing for this sport, because through this sport I met you, and it's a real pleasure and honor for this.
My why I like to travel is because of this. I like to stimulate other persons, and also meeting other persons that have the same energy and the same emotions on this, and try to show them to think in this way, because it's a beautiful way.
Yeah. this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.